This is a video diary of the building of my black Mirage, or as I call it, the werewolf, because it's kind of black and sinister looking. In the mid-90s, I found a Manta kit car, and I bought the chassis and just the fiberglass body. Fortunately, it still had good glass, so I started working on it in my workshop and small garage that I had in my backyard when I lived on the east side of Tucson. After a few years, I moved out to the desert west of Tucson and built a very nice workshop. So I had a well-lighted place to work and started to work on the Mirage again. I bought a used Donovan aluminum block from a fellow on the west coast and put some nice internals in it, including a nice Crower mechanical fuel injection. And as it turned out, this particular block had originally been sold to Dan Gurney's All-American Racers. I dropped the engine as it is a trial fit into the original chassis, and it looked like it was going to be a good installation. Here's the aluminum block next to a cast iron Chevrolet small block. The same thing. A Porsche G50 was a good choice for this application since it was mid-engine, had lots of gears. As it turned out, it was necessary to invert the transaxle so that I had 5 forward speeds instead of reverse. I added some triangulation to both side pods to increase the torsional stiffness and strength of the chassis. Riveting on stressed aluminum panels also increased the strength and stiffness of the chassis. The original chassis was set up for a VW trailing arm front end, which was definitely not going to be acceptable. I set it up for a Ford Mustang II geometry with rack and pinion steering. I modified the shifter to make it a little smoother over the original. Seems to work very well, and my wife Jolene seems to approve. I made the steering column out of 3/4 inch chrome moly tubing and ball bearing at the top as a support. The steering column uses 2 U-joints, one a Borgeson aluminum U-joint and the other one made by Apex. It's a military U-joint, frequently referred to as a helicopter joint. This is a mock-up of the front suspension using the Mustang II geometry. And the suspension units are coilovers made by Alden, front and rear. The front uprights are from Ford, Mustang II, they're Ford steel. And the calipers and rotors are from an 88 Corvette. They're nice aluminum calipers made in Australia. The original roll bar on the chassis was nowhere near adequate, so it was time to start working on a full SCTA compliant roll cage. I found a place in Tucson that could bend the type of tubing that I needed, and I made the front and rear hoops out of that, and I braced it fore and aft and put in a stainless steel firewall. Getting an idea of where the instrument panel should be and where my shoulder harness needs to be, and playing boy racer. To add some more protection, I put a titanium sheet across the top of the roll cage. The original Manta Mirage used a Corvair rear suspension, and this was not going to be adequate or possible with a Porsche G50 transaxle. So I cut off most of the rear suspension and chassis, and this actually reduced quite a bit of weight, as you can see. This left the rear of the chassis looking quite a bit different and needing a lot of additional modification. This is a mock-up of the rear suspension. Actually, I went through a couple of iterations on this, and this is not what I wound up as the final. But as you can see, it uses threaded rod ends and Alden coilover shocks. The rear brakes are definitely different. I wound up using a Porsche 928 S4 rotor and caliper. The calipers are nice four-piston calipers made by Brembo. Porsche wheels didn't come in the right size, and they wouldn't be legal anyway. So I had the rotors and the hubs remachined very slightly to make it a 5-on-5 pattern, 5 lugs on 5-inch diameter instead of 108 millimeters. And this allowed me to use Bassett racing wheels. They're fully welded steel wheels. And on these I mounted Goodyear slicks. The radiator is mounted on an assembly made of tubing and held in place with grommets to isolate the shock. The radiator is a Howe aluminum radiator made for stock car racing. Whoever drilled the holes in the front radiator support bracket did a terrible job. As you can see, with a little bit of load, they're going to tear right out. So I redid the whole front end attachment point, and at the same time I welded on a bracket so that the car can be towed. To improve the stiffness, I added a thin 6AL4V aluminum sheet across the bottom of the radiator support, and as you can see, there's lots of clecos and there'll be a lot of rivets in this. After bead blasting the support bracket, I painted it with a 2-part epoxy primer and a polyurethane top coat. Very hard material. The radiator support bracket now has the titanium sheet riveted to it. The rivets were pulled by this beautiful little FSI pneumatic hydraulic rivet puller. I made a heel support plate, which also is where the pedal assembly bolts to. I had originally built some pedals, but I was not quite satisfied with how it came out. So I made another set of pedals and found a bunch of aircraft aluminum extrusions and put everything together like a set of Tinker Toys. And it turned out relatively well. The pedals, I finished also with the epoxy primer. I bought the epoxy primer from Aircraft Spruce. It's a 2-part primer, and it gives a nice, smooth, hard, glossy finish. The battery is mounted on the forward end of the passenger footwell to balance the weight, and it's mounted in a closed battery box surrounded by some closed cell polyethylene foam for shock and bolted down very solidly. Okay, with the chassis turned upside down, it's time to fit a stressed aluminum panel across the bottom. Actually, this is a 7075 T6 065 panel that a friend of mine's father found lying on the side of Interstate 10. Drilling small diameter holes requires a high-speed drill, so I'm using a pneumatic drill here because I have a zillion holes coming up. And this is a countersink, an aircraft countersink that goes down just so far and stops. And it uses aircraft threaded drills, a quarter 28. And as you can see, there are a forest of clecos here. I'm finishing the welding on the chassis. I like to use a torch instead of a MIG or a TIG welder, but it's a personal choice. To move the chassis around so I can get it all angles, I just simply use my engine hoist to move it around. Looks a little like a race car, doesn't it? I added a bracket and bearing for the front anti-roll bar. A 10-gallon fuel cell is contained in the right side pod inside an aluminum container. A stress panel covers the container and is a mount for a fire extinguisher. This is a Freon type. I thought I would add provision to put in a dry sump tank. I'm not using it at the present, but if I have it there, it's a lot easier to put in now than it would be later. These halon extinguishers mount in the left side pod. They are halon types, and the white one is an automatic. Red one is a cable pull. Well, they don't race at night at Bonneville, so I don't need any headlights. So the pop-up headlight doors are going to be covered over with aluminum. Here it's just clecoed in, and these are closed-in rivets, so the salt doesn't wick up through from the inside of the fender. After it's finished, it's nicely smooth aerodynamically, and this is what it looks like when it's finished. I had bought some really nice aluminum rear hubs or uprights from Joe Huffaker over in California, and thought I would use those. It was originally for a Pontiac GTU, but I decided instead to go with a Porsche 996. So I got some hubs, cleaned them up, and gave them a good coat of zinc chromate, and I used the 5-link Porsche rear suspension geometry in this car. One of the CV joint boots was torn, so I took it apart and cleaned it up and took the CV apart and re-greased it and put a new boot on it. The instrument panel is starting to come together. I only have the vital instruments just to not provide any distraction. It's an aluminum panel with a little stiffener on there, and it also includes a little fire detector, so mid-engine, you're the last to know you're on fire. Instead of fuses, I decided that I would use circuit breakers, and I found an assortment of a very nice little what they call switch breakers. They're circuit breakers, but they have actuation handle that look like a toggle switch. And here's what the instrument panel looks like mounted in the front. And here is the rear. For indicators, I used rototail lights. They're lighted from the rear through a legend, and to change the bulbs, you just simply rotate it around so you don't have to get to the back of the panel. rest of them are just nice little aerospace indicators that I've changed the legend on to something appropriate. And as you can see, the rear of the instrument panel is shown, and the front of the circuit breaker panel is here. It has the master electrical off switch as well as the starter button. And here I've added the legends. Well, I'm still fooling around with the shift linkage, and I've put in some Thompson ball bushings, and it's better, but not perfect. To get a standard H pattern, I have to reverse the rotation of the shaft, so I did it here. And the shift rod is located with a number of bearings and support, a couple of universal joints on here as well. Regulations require that the windows be retained by tabs to prevent from blowing out, and I supported the tabs with Hi-Lox, which are a nice little one-side fastener, and the nut on a Hi-Lox, when it reaches the proper torque, it just simply twists off. You don't need a torque wrench. For fiberglass, a step drill works great. On a closed cockpit coupe, the SCTA requires roof rails, and these act as spoilers in case you get sideways at high speed. It kills the lift over the car. To fasten the rear bodywork down positively, I made a little bracket and use a quick release pin through it to hold the bodywork down. And an additional hold down is on the top with a pin and like a cotter pin. To get to the front pedals, it was necessary to cut an access panel in the fiberglass, and here I've cut it out and added a couple of stiffening ribs. And to fasten it on, I used a self-ejecting Zeus fastener. These are pretty convenient, and they don't have a lot of little loose components to lose. I'm fitting that panel back in place, and in addition, I cut an access panel in the side pod so that I could get to the fire extinguishers and the cooling tubes. For the small things where it's not worth getting out a paint gun and a compressor, I just use zinc chromate in a spray can. And for bigger stuff, I use a two-part epoxy that I mentioned before, made and sold by Aircraft Spruce. It's a very hard, glossy coating, and it wears extremely well. These are some panels that are painted with that two-part epoxy. Instead of one huge fan on the radiator, I decided that I would install six smaller industrial DC fans. And I had to make a panel and a bracket for it, and this acts like a plenum in front of the radiator. And by the way, these are not your El Cheapo little computer fans. These are heavy-duty industrial fans that move lots of air. My old fuel cell was totally shot and leaking badly. It was way out of its expiration date. So I decided that it was time to buy a new fuel cell. As I said, it's inside a protective aluminum can. And this is the new fuel cell. It's made by Fuel Safe. It's a polyurethane tough cell that withstands impact. And it's covered by that stress panel that I mentioned before. The filler is a screw-on cap with a check valve. For a fuel filter, I used a 10 micron 3000 PSI hydraulic filter, and I mounted it on a heat shield on the side of the engine compartment. As you can see, there is a fire extinguisher that's mounted there. This is the pull type halon extinguisher. And here is an additional 10 micron filter, one for the inlet and one for the outlet of the electric fuel pump. The ignition system is a Crane HI6 capacitive discharge system. It's a very powerful spark, and it is a multiple spark when it's cranking. It's mounted on aircraft shock mounts to protect it from vibration. Now it's time for the final cleanup of all of the chassis, and also to remove all of the parts that were mounted so that it can be hauled off into town on a trailer to a local sandblaster. Okay, it's back from the sandblaster, and he's done a very good job. He's taken it right down to the bare metal, so now it's ready for priming and painting. As you can see, the chassis is extremely strong, and the roll cage is quite extensive, but this is required at Bonneville, because if you crash, you may be 7 miles from help, so you have to survive all that time. Okay, the chassis is getting its coat of two-part epoxy primer. On top is an aerospace paint that is called an aliphatic isocyanate polyurethane resin. That's a heck of a mouthful, but it's an extremely good coating. I found it at a surplus place, made a ganga deal. I've used it. It was school bus yellow, but that's what it was in the cans, so that's what I used. Not too bad, though. These are the tools that I'll be using for fastening the stress panels. Here we have an air hydraulic riveter and a hand setter for nut certs and riv nuts, the old standby Marston hand riveter, and the PTI air hydraulic riveter for aerospace stuff. The first panel goes on the bottom, just in front of the engine. It has a stiffener panel that is made of titanium. This is a 7075 T6 stress panel on the bottom of the chassis. It's being held in place right now with Clico fasteners. And here are 451 blind rivets that are set. I couldn't have done this without a hydraulic riveter, even if I would Popeye. The lower firewall is made of 718 Inconel, a very high temperature stainless alloy. And here you can see the shift rod and the mount for the halon extinguisher behind the seat. And things are looking a little bit more finished, but a long way to go. Slowly, all the stuff that I took off is going back on, and sometimes it looks like a never-ending job, but we're getting there. You can see the rear suspension and also the rear anti-roll bar and down links. This is a little closer look of the rear anti-roll bar and the engine bay. The front bulkhead is now being fastened in place. The electrical components are mainly mounted on the passenger side, and the control for the master electrical off switch is a surplus aircraft contactor of some sort. Maybe not a B-17 because it's 12 volts. If it was a B-17, it'd be 24 volts. So that's what it looks like mounted in there. Here's some detail on the front suspension and the anti-roll bar with the down links. I use split shaft collars to locate the anti-roll bars front and rear. At Bonneville, a parachute is required above a certain speed, and so I had a parachute linkage and a swivel, so I added that. Here's the front suspension, and a look at the chassis and part of the roll cage with the titanium plate on the top. And I'm just looking to see what next needs to be done. This is at Inconel 718, lower firewall. It seems like the work on the shifter is never ending, but it's finally getting there. Made up some nice little threaded linkages to make it adjustable, and built some supports for the housing for the Thompson bearings. The fuel pump is a Carter competition fuel pump. Flows a lot of fuel, and here are the two fuel filters mounted on the heat shield. The left side heat shield contains a coolant recovery tank and a overflow recovery tank. I needed a vent tank for my transaxle, so I made one up of some sort of aluminum tank. I cut a hole in the top and had a very nice little atmospheric vent which I attached to the top, and it worked out fine. And here it is mounted to the chassis. This is some detail on how the lower part of the suspension coilover mounts, and this is what the 5-link Porsche rear suspension looks like. The battery box is mounted in these angles to keep it from sliding back and forth, and it's secured from the top very securely by a bar. The master electrical, as far as the battery shutoff is concerned, is a Moroso high current switch, and I mounted it so that it can be actuated by a rod from inside the cockpit or by a cable from the nose of the car where it's required to be positioned by the SCTA. You pull for the off. Since the battery is fully enclosed, there's no way of clipping on a charger onto the terminals. So I added an aircraft quick release battery charging port so I can either charge it or I can jump it. I like to use aircraft surplus fasteners whenever I can because they're extremely high quality. And here's an example of just some of the stuff that I use. It's usually high alloy steel, titanium, or A256 super alloy stainless. I made these to raise and lower the rear body work. This is the pivot point that bolts to the chassis. Your quick release pins that go through the rear section and then made some solid stays to hold the bodywork up. Some people use cables, but the first time the wind comes and it smacks it down on the back of your head, it's no fun. This is the rear firewall and the automatic extinguisher. I used the switch guard on the master electrical. So in case of emergency, you just bat it down with your gloved hand and everything goes off. This is the brace that goes across the top of the rear chassis, and it's where the ignition system and coil are mounted, as well as the parachute swivel. This is the pedal assembly. And on the other side of the bulkhead are the master cylinders. These are AFCO torpedo cylinders. The fluid reservoirs for the master cylinders are mounted above it on a bracket that I riveted together and used Parker Nyloflow tubing to connect. Rear anti-roll bar, and the primer part is the chassis brace across the top. At this point I thought, well, I wonder what the whole thing weighs. I have a spreadsheet, but let's just check it. I used a Dillon dynamometer, which is just a weight gauge, and lifted it up with my engine hoist, and you can see the result. This is the upper mount for the coilover suspension, bolts to the chassis. And most of the stuff I have is in double shear, or if it has to be in single shear, it's done with extremely heavy duty fasteners. And the washers, by the way, are required to keep the ball from pulling out of the housing. I added a couple of air dams across the bottom longitudinally to keep the airflow running under the car rather than let it spill out. It's made of angle and spliced because I didn't have long enough pieces for the one piece. I converted the original two-piece doors to a single piece that opened in a gull wing style. Used aircraft aluminum hinges, which are pretty heavy duty, -12s. The tail of the chassis is cut out to clear the Porsche transaxle, and the underside of the fiberglass rear bodywork is stiffened with a hat section to keep it from oil canning. Well, off we go on a rented trailer to go to Bonneville to see if we can get the tech inspectors to have a quick look and fix anything that might be necessary. Well, shoot, the event was rained out, and I just got a quick look from some inspectors. However, time to get it back and add a few things, including some tail fins, which are legal. These are some of the retaining tabs on the side windows. Armed with a half-inch drill with a long pilot drill and a hole saw, I started cutting out some of the vents in the front, top of the front fender. Used the blue tape to protect the gel coat and some thin aluminum on the bottom to protect the gel coat from the teeth of the hole saw. First, I put a array of holes, and then I used a saw to connect the holes and then open it. I showed a picture of what I'd done to my friend John Horsman, who has been chief engineer and managing director of John Wire Automotive Engineering, won Le Mans 3 times. And he said, well, I think you need to add one more vent a little bit further front on your fender. So that's what I did. And thank you, John. The rear vents were cut out same way, and all of the rest of them. The rear of the front body section was fastened to the chassis using stainless screws and an array of floating nut plates. You can see the bear claw door latch in both of these pictures. I cut the inside of the door to accommodate an interior latch, and I used a Southco door handle to act as a inside door latch with the bear claw arrangement. To prop the doors open in gullwing fashion, I made a couple of vertical stays that can be inserted to hold the doors open. Now this photo shows both doors open all the way. All of the coolant lines were beaded on the ends to keep the hoses from slipping off under pressure. Here's how the radiator was plumbed. Silicone hoses and stainless tubes. Although the Crower mechanical injection is a very nice unit and probably make lots of horsepower, mechanical injection is a learning curve I just didn't want to get into right now. So I swapped it over to a carburetor. In this case, it's a Holley 850 double pumper, and it sits on a manifold made by Edelbrock. It's called a 4+4, a rather unusual manifold and not seen very often. The name of the manifold is probably not one of Edelbrock's better marketing decisions, since a lot of people thought that 4+4 meant it was for a four-wheel drive. But in actuality, it's a good flowing manifold, and it's related to the Victor series. This particular manifold has been machined for EFI bungs, which I may use in the future, but for now, I've sealed those up. I was a little leery of the pilot bearing as a needle bearing, so I did a lot of research and I found another bearing, which was a ball bearing, that fit into the Kennedy flywheel nicely. So I replaced that and it seems to fit quite well. Lining up the clutch and pressure plate was a miserable job with this cheapo plastic spline tool. I finally gave up on it. It was just too wobbly and used a good metal one. And here is the Kennedy pressure plate. I used a small IMI mini high torque starter that's a geared unit. This is a really bad idea that Porsche had, using needle bearings on the clutch fork. It unfortunately has a capability of seizing. When a shaft rotates back and forth in a needle bearing in a very limited angle, it wears a groove in the lubrication and it eventually causes fretting in a shaft and it seizes. I replaced it with a Fabroid bearing and modified the throw-out fork accordingly. Since the G50 is inverted, I had to swap the vent and the drain plugs, but that was easy, and I threaded in an AN fitting so that I could run a hose over to the breather tank. Since I had a single master cylinder in the brake line, I used a pressure limiting valve for the rear. And I originally used that one, but then I changed it to a dial type because of the way it was mounted. It was easier to get to. One automatic fire extinguisher is located behind the seat back. The automatic fire extinguishers cover the engine compartment, engine bay, and the manual pull type cover the driver's cockpit area. These are the nozzles that spray the Freon or Halon into the cockpit and suppress the fire. For the automatics, I made a bracket for the automatic nozzles, and they're pointed at the headers and the oil pan, since that's where the fire is most likely to happen. The Kitty Aerospace fire detector is a two wavelength infrared detector that detects flickering fire. The front bulkhead is now finished. It contains the new Flaming River rack and the anti-roll bar, the torpedo master cylinders, and the reservoirs. Here I made a small bracket throttle stop so I don't overstress the carburetor linkage. To comply with the SCTA rules, I had to seal off the engine bay from the cockpit. So I added some more Inconel 718 to seal off that area. There can't be any light showing even. The water pump is driven off the crank pulley as usual. There is no alternator, so the battery runs the whole thing since it's a limited amount of time that you're on the course. Here you can see some of the routing of the coolants. Bleeding air out of the cooling system is always a problem with a mid-engine car since the radiator sits low and the engine sits higher, so I added a bleed valve at the top of the thermostat housing, and I made it out of some surplus aircraft pieces that I found that seemed to do the job when properly assembled. And so there's a small valve that is like a tire valve. You push it in and it bleeds air out, and safety wired it all together and screwed it into the top of the thermostat housing. More unidentified aircraft stuff. I found these neat little filters. They're stainless steel mesh filters, and I cut a couple of holes in one side of the cast aluminum dart valve covers, and I mounted the filters in the top as breathers, and worked out very nicely. In the other valve cover, I mounted one breather and another unidentified piece as a threaded cap as an oil filler. Again, I used the engine hoist and dynamometer to weigh the complete engine, see what it weighed, together with the heads and everything complete to go into the engine bay. And here is the result. Obviously, an aluminum lock and an aluminum heads make a big difference. Now I'm ready to hoist the complete engine and transaxle up and drop it into the engine bay. This is a view underside of the engine bay. As you could see looking forward, it's pretty smooth. The original Manta Mirage chassis used the lower chassis tubes to run the coolant, but there are problems with overheating. Now you can see why. To avoid that whole mess, I used stainless steel thin wall tubing all the way through and used T-bolt clamps, silicone hoses, and Gates power band heat shrink clamps, which I recommend. Very uniform pressure all the way around, and they seal up nicely. You can see the two types of clamps here. A very nice, smooth transition with the Gates power band. At Bonneville, at this speed range, a parachute is required. I found a parachute swivel from some military parachute, added it. I fabricated a swing away lateral head restraint to go alongside my helmet, and it worked okay, but it wasn't the best. I added a sight gauge to the oil pan so I can tell how much oil I have. The dipstick in this block was not working. The fiberglass seat tub has an access port to get to the halon extinguisher behind it. I was assigned number 291 by the SCTA, so it's time to put on some decals. The BGMS stands for B is engine size, and G is for gas, and M is for modified sports. Now it's beginning to look like a real race car, isn't it? I ordered a parachute from Stroud Safety and a launcher, and this is a spring launcher that you wind up, and when you pull a release cable, it fires the parachute out up into the airstream where it blossoms. But winding up the spring wasn't easy. So I fabricated a tool to make the job a lot easier. It looks like there's plenty of headroom, doesn't it? Well, with a Dash 20 fire suit and the larger helmets that they have these years, it ate it up completely. To generate some additional downforce in the rear, I fabricated a spoiler which goes in between the two fins, as stiffened by a titanium hat section, and uses Dash 12 aluminum aircraft hinges, which are plenty strong, and it has a couple of supports in the rear that are threaded, and the angle can be adjusted. It has a small gurney lip also on the rear. So off we go to Bonneville again, stopping in Boulder City overnight, and we arrived at the salt and eventually got unloaded and set up our pit. Alas, they didn't like the firewall. They wanted it extended all the way out to the edge of the body. So it's haul it back and start working on that. I used aluminum with a heat reflective zirconia fiber insulating film. The tech inspectors also wanted the top of the fuel cell isolated from the cockpit completely, so I made a nice firewall there. And also I replaced the old Goodyears with some brand new Hoosiers. Okay, back at Bonneville, and we are here, and eventually we get to tech inspection, and voila. After tech inspection, which is pretty comprehensive, we tow the car back to the staging lane and suit up and get ready to run. This is what the course looks like from on it. I stalled the engine and then ran it to first gear. It was running ratty and shifted to second and started misfiring and the power went away. And here is my slip. 65 miles an hour. Okay, time to go back and tear things down, which I did. Tore the engine block down and found that I had made a couple of rookie mistakes. The worst one was that I had forgotten the cam button, so the cam was running back and forth and retarding the timing. So I had a chance to put in some new bearings. Here are some brand new King main bearings. Have a special coating on it. Unfortunately, my crankshaft turned out to be okay, and I had them just polish it a little bit. Gary's Machine Shop here in Tucson did a really nice job. They delivered it when they said they would, and they charged me what they said it was going to cost. The pistons are aluminum forgings made by Cosworth in the UK, and I added a graphite molybdenum disulfide coating. And the rod bearings looked ratty, so I replaced those also with the new set of King bearings. And as you can see, the engine's coming together. You can see the Ursin timing gear on the front and the roller rockers. The other major problem with the engine was that the Holley carburetor was just junk. There was something wrong with it. It was either warped or had some casting flaws or something. So I replaced it with a Proform 850. It's a double pumper, four-corner idle adjust, and lots of advanced features. A nice carburetor. I also took the opportunity to replace the organic clutch disc with a metallic one and a higher coefficient of friction and a higher torque rating. The clutch and the disc are both Kennedy Engineering. One of the problems that I had too with the shifter was that the rod is too soft and the balls and the bearing were Brunelling the shaft. So I replaced the tubing with a shaft made of K60 from Thompson. It's extremely hard stuff. And the balls, since they didn't want to rotate, I replaced with a bearing housing made by Thompson that has a fluorocarbon bearing surface. It fits in the same cartridge, so here are both of them combined. The stuff is so hard that it requires grinding through the surface in order to drill a hole through the shaft. I revised the rear shift linkage once again. Seems like that's all I've been doing. And to make the link that reverses the rotation, I fabricated a little link made of a ball bearing on one end and a spherical rod end bearing on the other. So everything's back together again, ready to run. It's loaded on the trailer and we're ready to go. And guess what? COVID-19 and the whole thing is canceled. Well,